Okay, so let's look at digital certificates and PKI, or the public key infrastructure. So with this, what we do is that we prove identity mainly, and we will see this in HTTPS. And with HTTPS, we make sure that Bob can identify Alice. So part of HTTPS is to make sure that Bob can identify the web server that he's connecting to. But along with this, we use key exchange to make sure that we can create an encrypted tunnel between Bob and Alice. So there are three main things going on here. We use symmetric key, typically with AES, to be able to create the tunnel. We use key exchange, such as the Diffie-Hellman method, to be able to negotiate a key between Bob and Alice for the tunnel. But along with this, we use public key encryption with a private key and a public key to be able to prove Bob and Alice. So this is our key pair here. And on the internet, this is typically RSA or ECC, elliptic curve cryptography. Okay, so if we just step through, we have Diffie-Hellman for the key exchange that generates a shared key, and we will use a symmetric key algorithm such as AES, and that will create the tunnel between them. But how does Bob and Alice make sure that they can identify each other? Well, they do this through a key pair. And the basics of this is that if we have Bob and Alice, and Bob wants to identify himself to Alice, then what he'll do is to take some data, and then he will have a key pair. So he'll have a private key and a public key. So Bob will take the data and then create an encrypted hash. So take the data and then encrypt the hash with his private key. You can then send that over, and then Alice will also take the hash of the message. And then we'll take Bob's encrypted hash and then use Bob's public key to be able to decrypt that. The output will be another hash, and if the hashes compare, then Bob has proven that he's Bob, because only Bob will have the private key. Okay, so it's this key pair which makes sure that we can identify Bob to Alice. We can also use public key encryption to be able to encrypt data between Bob and Alice, and we'll see that later. Most of the time we use symmetric key for that though. Okay, so let's look at digital certificates. So with digital certificates, we get a format known as X509, which is a standard way that we can represent a certificate. The two certificates that we get are one with a key pair and one with just the public key on it. In this case, this is kept secret because we don't want the private key to be leaked. So we will export the public key from the key pair to the public key and then sign that onto a digital certificate. The main formats that we get are P7B and PEM. These are Base64 formats. Key pair is in the form, can be in the form of PEM, and the P7B is a certificate that we can distribute, and it's stored in that in terms of a Base64 format. We can also get PFX files, which are password protected and DER ones there. But those files store the public key. So basically what we want is that we want Bob to be able to send Alice his public key in a trusted way. So the public key needs to come over, and Alice needs to know that that is Bob's public key. And what we don't want is for Eve to send a fake public key for Bob in that way. So we introduce the concept of Trent. So with that, we have Bob and Alice, and they both trust Trent. And Trent is trusted to create a digital certificate that proves Bob's public key. So basically, Trent gets Bob's public key. Then Trent will sign with his private key to create a signature for the digital certificate to hold Bob's public key. Alice will then check the certificate to see if it's been signed by Trent, because she will have Trent's public key. So she checks that to make sure that it has been signed by Trent, and then she'll take Bob's public key from the certificate and can now identify Bob. So how do we get this cert from Trent to back to Bob for Bob to distribute to Alice? Well, we can do that with a code signing request. And with a code signing request, we generate some key pairs. Okay, so we have Bob here. So Bob initially creates his key pair. Here, and then creates a code signing request. The code signing request takes his public key and will get it ready to send to Trent. Trent receives this and will have created his own key pair, public key and a private key. And then from this, Trent will create a CA certificate. And this is a certificate authority certificate. And this will contain the public and the private key required to be able to prove Trent's identity. So from there, Trent then creates the certificate. Which has been signed with Trent's private key. And on there, there will be Bob's public key. So Trent will take a hash of the certificate with the public key contained in it, and then with that hash will encrypt the hash with Trent's private key. After that, Bob can then distribute the certificate to Alice, and Alice will take Bob's public key and then be able to decrypt the signature hash and produce the hash of the certificate. If that is the same as the hash value that she will generate from the certificate, then she knows that the certificate contains Bob's public key. And in this way, we make sure that Trent's public key is stored on Alice's computer so that she can check any certificate which has been signed by Trent. Okay, so now let's look at a fuller version of PKI. Now we have Bob, and we have Alice. And in this case, we're going to use the full power of public key encryption. Not with this, but we will use public key encryption to show how Bob and Alice can communicate secretly, but also prove their identity to each other. Okay, so let's start, and we'll define Bob's public key and Alice's public key. We'll then take Bob's private key and Alice's private key. And then we obviously need Trent. So we have Trent here. And Trent will be responsible for signing each of the certificates that we generate to hold the public keys. So there is Trent's key, and here is his public key. Okay, so here are the keys that we have. So let's say that Bob is sending a message to Alice, and Bob wants to prove his identity, but also to make sure that Eve can't read the encrypted message. So the first thing that we'll do is to be able to take a hash of the message, and then with Bob's private key, he will then encrypt the hash of the message. Okay, so we have the message and we have the hash of the message, and the hash has been encrypted with Bob's public key. We will then take Alice's public key and encrypt the whole of the message. Okay, so in this case, we've taken this key here for the signing or the encrypting of the hash, and we'll take Alice's public key and encrypt the whole of the message here. The way that Bob can get Alice's public key is obviously from Trent, from a signed certificate from Trent. So the public key that he receives will have been signed by Trent as a digital certificate. So Trent would have signed the public key with his private key. We send this over. Yep. And inside we have the message and then the signed hash. Alice will then take her private key and then be able to decrypt the encrypted message with her private key. This will give her the message from there. Next, she'll take a hash of the message and then decrypt the encrypted hash with Bob's public key. So this key here will come over and then decrypt the hash. So she'll end up with two hashes there, and if they're the same, then she knows that Bob was the one that signed the hash here. And the way that she'll get Bob's public key is that she'll receive a digital certificate signed by Trent with a public key on it, and she will check Trent's public key, which should be installed on her machine, to make sure that she has Bob's public key. And in this way, we will verify both the message and that it hasn't been changed, along with Bob signing the message. One little change that we can have with this is that we can use symmetric key encryption. So in this process here, if what we do is to take a symmetric key that we generate with the message and with Bob's hash in here, and we generate a symmetric key, then what we can then do is encrypt the message with this symmetric key, but we can use Alice's public key to be able to encrypt this key that's been used to encrypt the message, so that when this is sent back, Alice will use her private key to be able to unencrypt the symmetric key, and then with the symmetric key she'll be able to open up the message and the signature here. So this is the pure form of public key encryption, of how we would use it without symmetric key, but this shows an enhancement where we only have to encrypt a small key value here with public key encryption to make sure that we can communicate securely. Okay, so this has provided an overview of public key encryption.